listening to episode 97 of Mitolife Radio. I'm your host, Matt Blackburn. Today I'm speaking with Kitty Blomfield, all the way from Australia. Her and her partner, Craig, run the Win It Life program and the Win It Life podcast, and really help women especially, but everybody, to heal their metabolism, to get away from restrictive diets, to lower stress, and really come back into balance. So they offer personalized nutrition, meal plans, recipe books, shopping lists, which is really cool because I find that a lot of people are just confused about what to eat. And we talk about that in this podcast episode, just basic nutrition and foods that help support your metabolism. And you really don't have to restrict or make it super difficult. And that's what I really love about their program. It's just very simple. And a lot of people don't need to know the biochemistry. I'm interested in that. I like speaking with people on how it all works. But a lot of people just want results. And Kitty and Craig have tons of testimonials of people that have gotten results on their program and just on a pro-metabolic program in general, of not restricting macronutrients and maybe even cutting back on workouts to lower stress or changing the structure of your exercise routine. And that might be scary to a lot of people because it's all about weight loss. That's a big factor. And that's why we talk quite a bit about body image in this episode and how that leads to restrictive dieting and starvation diets and just rebounding and losing weight and gaining it back. It is truly a vicious cycle, and we do not want to get caught in that. So here is Kitty Blomfield. All right, I'm here with Kitty Blomfield. Welcome to the show.
Oh, hey, Matt. Thanks so much for having me on.
Yeah, thanks so much for coming on the show. It's been really fun to speak with you. I've been on your program a few times talking about PUFAs and different things, and I just really appreciate how you simplify this information for people, because we were just talking about how it can get so complex, and that question, where do I start, is a common one with people, right? Coming off of restrictive diets and binge eating and keto and all that.
Totally. And, you know, like we've had you on a couple of times in our podcast, and we got such great feedback, especially from the polyunsaturated fats one. And a lot of my listeners said, oh, it was just really great how Matt explained it in such simple terms, because I think that, you know, I'm certainly no nutrition guru, not like you or, you know, like my business partner, Emma. And when I first stumbled across Ray Pete and I'll rewind back. I was getting divorced, and when I don't know if other people have done this, but I, in my teenage years and a bit older, I took a lot of drugs and drank a lot of alcohol, and I had a lot of body image issues, which then I guess manifested themselves in the restrictive diet. So I was always looking for that diet that was going to keep me skinny and keep me lean. And I tried everything, you know, I did keto, I did fasting, and I was really like so anti-sugar. I was that friend that was always banging on about the sugar and the dairy and all these things you shouldn't eat, but then I'd be binge eating on the weekend because I couldn't control my cravings, you know. And then I got divorced, and I was seeing this therapist, and she said to me, because we'd always talk about nutrition, because obviously I was always trying to find that diet, the diet that was going to be the one that could keep me skinny. And she said, you know, women that have thyroid issues shouldn't eat green vegetables. And I was like, what do you mean? Like, shouldn't everyone eat green vegetables? Because I used to eat, like, I would literally eat them with every meal. I'd eat green beans, tuna and flaxseed for morning tea, big salad with spinach, you know, green cucumber and anything green for afternoon tea, and then big plate of broccoli for dinner. And she said, go away and read the work of this guy, Dr. Ray Pete, and this nutritionist, Emma, which was Emma. And I went and read some of Ray's articles. And look, I think a lot of people are like me. You know, I'm not stupid, but I'm not like super intelligent. So a lot of his stuff I found difficult to really understand and interpret. And how do I apply that? So, and this, if you haven't read this article of Emma's, it's called Defending, not you, I know you would have read it, but Defending Fruit and Other Non-Complex Carbs. I read that and you know, all these light bulbs were just going off in my head. And I was thinking, sometimes I swear, everyone. So if you're offended by swearing, you should probably stop listening now. But I was like, holy shit, this makes so much sense to me. Like I was restricting sugar, restricting carbs. And then this is why I've been this way my whole life. And the fitness industry has been lying to me. So off I went and worked with Emma. And everything she said to me just made so much sense. And, you know, from there I met Craig and he introduced me to strength training because I used to just do a lot of cardio. You know, I was doing training every single day, 2 to 3 hour training sessions, fasting, low carbs. So I started to eat more carbs, started drinking orange juice, you know, eating more sugar, started lifting heavy weights. And it really transformed, you know, it transformed my body, my health, and it really allowed me to heal the relationship with myself, I think. You know, when I finally healed that relationship with food, it really opened the doors to heal every other part of me. And I think that's why I'm so passionate about helping women get off that restrictive diet train. And I think when you start, you dive into this world of Ray Pete and some of the other people that we, you know, follow or inspire by, it can be really confusing, I think. I mean, I don't know. I don't know what how your clients are like. I mean, you're a bit of a brainiac, Matt, so I'm sure you probably just read it more like, oh, yeah, I get it. I'm on it, you know?
No, it took me a while, yeah. And we had a very similar background. I was anti-sugar for years. I was one meal a day. I was not doing dairy. And it's kind of a direction, right? Like I think most people with the high vegetables, the no carb, the intermittent fasting, they're going the anti-metabolism direction. But when you start to learn all this stuff, you're going the right direction. I was just talking with my plumber yesterday. He was fixing my whole house water filter. And he was like, I've been helping him out. And he's like, I get migraines every day.
Yeah.
And I was kind of trying to explain this concept to him. And I gave him some methylene blue. I gave him some niacinamide.
Yeah, wow. You know?
And I was like, it's just about going this direction, right? And your brain's probably just starving for glucose, right? I mean, that's a cause of the headache.
Well, I think the thing though that like it's so, and I guess we've been doing this for all, and same as you, that I'm a bit insulated now and I forget what the rest of the world is like in the industry. And, you know, people are so brainwashed into believing that they shouldn't eat sugar, that it's poison, that it causes cancer, that it causes diabetes, which is so far from the truth. It was so interesting. I went down this morning to get a coffee. We ran out of coffee beans. So I just walked down to our little coffee shop, grabbed the beans. I thought, I'll get a coffee while I'm here because they make amazing coffee. And I said to the lady, can I have a tall latte? I like it extra hot. And can I have 5 sugars? And she was just like, whoa, 5 sugars. And then I walked over to wait for it. And I was having a chat to the owner and she's really nice. And she's like, oh, 5 sugars. I was like, yeah, I love my sugar. And she goes, oh, our dishy was having 5 sugars in her coffee, but I've got it down to 3. So I've just really helped her live longer by reducing her sugar intake. And of course, like I never say anything now because I don't say things to people about it that I know aren't ready, you know. And I said to her, oh, is your dishy slim? And she goes, yeah, she's really slim. And I was like, right, it's the sugar, you know, like. But it's just so interesting how that it is really so anti-sugar. Actually, we went for a coffee with our landlords next door that have moved out. We became good friends with them. And they had breakfast and Craig and I had coffee. Gritty had our breakfast. And again, I put heaps of sugar in. He's like, oh, you shouldn't be eating all that sugar, Kitty. It's crazy.
So is 5 sugars, like, are you talking about the sugar cubes or packets? Or
it's like 5 teaspoons. It would be equivalent to 5 teaspoons, yeah. Because I like to have coffee first thing in the morning with breakfast. You know, so I need, and I, cause I've got a lot of muscle, you know, and a high metabolism, I need a lot of carbs in the morning to just, especially cause the coffee, you know, drops your blood sugar. And I find if I don't have that much with it, it's just like, you know, you get that low blood sugar effect after, you can just feel it. Yeah. So
yeah, Yeah, I think these basic concepts are important for people to understand. Mm. Like, what if you have protein, have sugar with it, and it's because I came from the fruitarian world. I'm still friends with fruitarians, and I think the liver needs protein, right? Good amino acids from animal protein, and I think a lot of people don't know, like, a steak will raise insulin, and if you don't have carbohydrates coming in, and that'll drop your blood sugar and cause a need for cortisol and adrenaline, which will then cause this cascade of estrogen raising and all these negative effects, right? So it's kind of like always having carbs and protein, and then if you're gonna have coffee after, right?
Yeah And you know, it's just, I think that these basic principles, you know, everyone should know, because these are the things, like, the women in our program that get the best results really come in and do the basics. You know, we teach them how to balance their meals so they have, you know, 2-to-1 protein, carbs to protein or higher. You know, eat the carrot salad every day, eat the liver, eat the oysters. You know, you're going to get the nutrients you need to really build a strong and robust metabolism, and so your body functions optimally. And we run these challenges. They're not like weight loss challenges. They're like, they're called break free. So it's like giving you the foundations to restore your metabolism and you know, start building that body that you want. And a lady said to me, I interviewed her yesterday, and said, "Oh, Kitty, your program's so life changing." She's like, "I've come from another program, does similar to you." And she's like, "I never even knew about balancing my blood sugar and planning out my meals." And she's like, "Just that alone, I feel so much better." You know, and it really, it's just, and you think about, you know, I always think about my body like it's like this machine, right? Like if you're going to drive a car to the other side of Australia and only put half a tank of fuel in, what's going to happen? Well, you're not going to make it. But the human body's not like that. It has built-in mechanisms to help it survive. So you run out of fuel, your stress hormones rise to compensate, you know, breaks down your muscle tissue, uses fat for fuel, and that's really stressful, you know. And I think women, they just think, "Oh God, I want to get into shape. I've got to cut calories. I've got to cut carbs," which then just ends up depleting their body of minerals, progesterone, you know, they break down their muscle and they end up with, you know, menstrual cycle issues, poor sleep, and then they just, their metabolism's slow, and then they go and binge eat because they can't restrict anymore, and then they just gain heaps of weight and they're stuck in this vicious cycle. But really, when you just bring it back to basics, it's like, eat regularly, eat protein, carbs and fat at every meal, you know, eat foods that are easy for your body to digest. But I think, I feel like sometimes people just overcomplicate it when it's not that complicated, you know, like if you're tired, don't train. If you haven't had a good sleep, don't train, you know, get sun, have downtime. But I think we've just become, I don't know, you know, like looking out there, there's so many different diets, there's so many ways to train, but we've just moved so far away from actually listening to our body. Just listen to your body.
I love that. Yeah. And it seems like women especially, I mean, there's some men, but women like are hyper-focused on weight loss, right?
Totally.
Like, that was a lot of the questions people were curious about. It's like, how do I lose weight? And they always get freaked out when they gain some body fat by reintroducing carbs. And people have been programmed that carbs, you know, create body fat, right? Carbs make you fat.
yeah. And I think like I know I just keep talking about women in our program, but because we typically attract women that want to, Our avatar would be women that have done every single diet under the sun like me, and they've either had to really severely restrict to maintain their weight, or then they've restricted and binged a heap and they've put on a heap of weight. And, you know, I think if you're a woman like me, like I'm actually heavier now than I was when I started this journey. So I always, my goal weight was 62 kilos. I always had this, I don't know, it was just in my mind I had to be 62 kilos. So I would obviously cut calories, cut carbs to stay under that, do lots of cardio, and then it would go a bit above that and then I'd restrict again. But I guess I think for a lot of women, you've got to realize maybe that potentially the weight that you think that you should be is not actually a healthy weight for you, you know? Like it's for me, I mean, I obviously started strength training too, so I put on muscle as well. But my body fat is higher now, I think, than it was when I was really starving myself. But I'm obviously a lot healthier because as a female, you know, we're meant to make babies. We're meant to make babies. Like, if you are really low body fat, your body's going to go, well, you know, like, reproduction is not an essential. It's not essential. Like, we can survive without reproducing. So when, you know, as a female, if you severely cut calories and restrict and do heaps of cardio, your body's going to go, well, I'm going to turn off that menstrual cycle. Or there's going to be menstrual cycle irregularities. And we see it all the time with women in our program. And I had it previously too. And now that I'm eating more, you know, and getting the right nutrients in, my cycle now is regular and pain-free, and it's not really heavy. You know, and I think it's, we're so focused on how we look rather than our health. And, you know, it's a hard, I think if you're listening to this and if you're a woman, it can be, it's a head fuck. It is when you start this, because if you're someone like me who's always been small, really small, when you have to put on weight and you've always potentially got your self-worth from how you look, it becomes really difficult to go, okay, I'm putting on more body fat, I'm heavier than I am. You know, I actually threw out all of my clothes that I had when I was small, because I was like, I'm never going to get back into those again, you know? And I don't know if you work with women too, that is, I know I keep talking about women because we work with women, but if you work with women like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I remember I love your stories on social media, on Instagram, and you had one where you were talking to, they're really funny. You were talking to Craig and he was saying that he likes you with extra body fat, right? Cause there's more curves. Yeah. And I think that whole body image aspect, I want to talk about for a minute, because I think with magazines and television and motion pictures, there's this programming. I mean, both in men and, I mean, for men, it's like six pack abs, right? And for women, it's like super lean and model type. But I don't know, men actually like curves. I don't know if women know that. They don't like super lean. You know.
Totally. Like, and look, I'm a bit of an oversharer, so you can cut this bit out if you want to. But like, you know, Craig always says to me, he's like, oh, do you love it when you're fatter? He's like, when you've put a bit more physique, your ass is really jiggly, you know, when I'm having sex with you from behind, you know, it's really great. It's nice to have, you got a bit of jiggle there. He said, the only thing though is it makes my cock look smaller. So he's like, that's the only bad thing. But again, it's not about what, I think it's important to understand, it's not about what men think about you, but there is that definitely like disconnection. Like, we think, oh, men will like us when we're really lean and hard. And it's like, well, you're a woman. Like, you know, you're meant to have some curves. I mean, I've got muscles and curves. I like to have muscles too, because I like strength training. But, you know, I think, like, when you start this process, and if you do gain some body fat, you've just got to consistently bring yourself back to, why am I doing this? And focus on, I'm sleeping better. I'm not obsessed with, like, I used to be obsessed with food. It's all I'd think about. I'd get up in the morning and I'd think about what I could eat, what I couldn't eat, what I was going to eat on the weekend with my binge eating. And, you know, you've got to just keep focusing on, I want to be healthier, I want to sleep better, you know. And I think often too, I've found with women is that they may gain weight initially, but then things will drop. Like, depending on, you know, some women just need to gain weight and sit at a higher body fat and a higher weight. It's just what it is. But some will then, things will stabilize, and then they'll find that they'll lose weight, you know, once their body feels safe, and they're not so depleted anymore, you know, because healing takes energy, takes nutrients, it takes excess, because you've been depleted for so long. You know, then they find that they actually lose that weight over the long term.
Yeah. For me, I was underweight for years. Like, I couldn't break like 135, and I gained like 10 to 15 pounds healing my metabolism. For me, that was a good thing.
Yeah.
Cause I needed it. And so I think whether overweight or underweight, it's a suppressed metabolism, right? It's
totally. There. Yeah. And you know, I really, cause we work with a lot of women who binge eat, a lot of bigger women who've just binged. And I think that once they, and I find when they start in our program, we're really trying to encourage them to eat more food consistently. Cause I'm like, look, you didn't get to 100 kilos eating 1200 calories. You didn't. It's not possible. Like, you've restricted. And then they talk to me more, like, yeah, you're right, Kitty. I try and eat 1000 calories during the week. And then I have these epic binges. So my metabolism's slow. And then, you know, they're eating foods like pufas, all the vegetable oils, the flours, just the shitty, you know, takeaway foods, KFC. And then when they actually eat more consistently throughout the day, more sugars, eat foods that, you know, they like that they think that they shouldn't be eating, like ice cream, homemade fudge, fruits, juice. They're like, oh my God, all of a sudden I'm not binge eating anymore. You know, like we've had women in our program start at like just under 100 kilos and have lost 30 kilos and they're eating 2,400 calories a day, you know, like because they're consistent and they consistently fuel their body. They strength train to get to build muscle and get stronger and they break free from that restrict and then binge. And I, you know, look, I think too, a lot of women, and I was the same, like I used food and alcohol as a way to suppress things or cope with things. So like, or I'd starve myself as a way to control things that were happening in my life, you know, and I think a lot of women, even men probably do it, maybe, I don't know.
Yeah, absolutely. You have me thinking about ice cream real quick. Because I saw your recipe and you sell casein and collagen, right? And yeah, you have your little ice cream maker. Every time I see that, I'm drooling. I'm like, I got to get on that. You add cream and eggs and salt. And that's basically it, right?
It's so simple. It's the easiest recipe. It's just milk, cream, egg yolks, sugar, of course, some vanilla essence. And then I just add the casein and the gelatin in just to boost up the protein. And, you know, the casein's quite good. It just helps to – it's a slow-digesting protein. So if you have it at night before bed, got to make sure you have a good dose of sugar with it though. Again, with the whole – the protein, too much protein will drop your blood sugar. It just helps to keep you full through the night. And I think that's another misconception, but obviously your listeners will know that's, you know, they all know to eat a good bedtime snack, I think.
Yeah. I tried your casein for the first time last night and I mixed it in my homemade raw goat milk and it made it really thick. It was interesting.
Yeah.
Cause I feel like I was mixing like cow and goat together. I'll probably mix it in cow's milk next time, or I'm still trying to figure out.
It's not, it's not really delicious because it's just pure casein, you know, like most caseins have got flavors and additives and things to stop it from clumping, but because ours is just pure, I think the key is blend it, but it does make things go thicker because it doesn't have any anti-caking agents or anything in it either. Did you get the recipe book? I've got to send you the recipe book with it.
I need to get that. I mean, maybe I'll just make a ton of ice cream with it.
Yeah. I'll send it to you. But yeah, I think it's not like, you know, some of those really crappy protein powders that taste amazing. It obviously doesn't taste like that because it's got none of those things in there. Yeah.
I thought it tasted pretty good. I mean, to me, I don't know. I mean, maybe mixing some colostrum or something, you could find the right. But you sell cascara sagrada too, right? You have a few things.
Yeah. Cool. Cascara is amazing. And that's probably one of our best-selling products. Like it's really, I think, helpful because a lot of people, when they start this journey, you know, slow metabolism, low thyroid function, they constipated, you know, things aren't moving. And it's really good just to sort of get things moving and it's, you know, anti-inflammatory and it's got other benefits. Like Ray uses it. We got a really nice email from Catherine, his partner, saying that he's loves it and he's tried it and yeah, which is cool. And, you know, taking it consistently, but in doses that don't have a laxative effect. So small, like a tiny bout can be really beneficial. Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah. My whole bowel journey has been interesting because I was eating when I was vegan, like a salad the size of my head. And so I was getting tons of fiber every day, like raw vegetable fiber for a year, like five, 6 years, long time. And the raw carrot salad, you really inspired me to do that daily because I was dabbling, you know, a few times a week. Yeah. But I really noticed kind of shred. I'm still trying to figure out how to make it easier. You know, shredding it by hand takes forever.
I'm going to give you my tips, all right? So because I like to prep things in advance too. You know, like we're really busy, same as you, run multiple businesses. So, and I know it's a bit of a ball ache grading it. I agree. It is annoying that way. But if you just do like four or five or six in a row, put them in a big jar and then fill it with water and just change the water every day as you use it and it makes it heaps quicker. But, you know, I think if that's probably one thing, simple thing that people can do that can be so beneficial. Another really simple and cheap. It's so cheap.
Yeah. And I noticed a difference in hormones. Like I feel like it boosts my testosterone. I can just feel that if I eat it consistently. the detox is like serotonin,
estrogen. Yeah. Endotoxin. So many women like will message me going, oh my God, like I've just finally got my shit together and I'm being really consistent with the carrot salad. And all of a sudden I've noticed my hot flushes are gone. You know, my periods become regular. So it is, and it's so cheap. Like carrots are so cheap. Yeah.
Yeah. It's awesome. My bowel movements are better with that because I notice it's easy to get low fiber on what I'm doing because I don't have fruit up here in Idaho too much. So I just
get
fiber from potatoes. And I mean, if it's non-local.
Yeah.
In between barracks. Yeah.
Do you drink much juice? I don't really notice you. Are you into the juicy OJ? I never really know. Like, because obviously I watch your Instagram stories about what you're eating. I never really noticed juice in there.
I probably need to just bite the bullet and buy non-local, even though I know they were picked unripe and there's that whole thing to deal with. But I'm sure you can mitigate that somehow.
Mm.
But I did juice a ton of apples, took them over to my neighbor's house. We did the apple press.
Yeah, so was it good?
I still have like 3 gallons of apple juice in the freezer.
I actually quite like apple juice, fresh apple juice. It's like that cloudy. It's really yummy. Yeah, you're right. It is like over here in Australia, this is a brand called Nudie. And sometimes, which I'm actually drinking now as we speak, it can be a bit sour. So Craig and I, like there's this great fruit shop near us that just sells local oranges that they're always consistently good. Like, because I have one for breakfast. I eat one with my eggs in the morning. So I just love oranges. And so we bought this little hand presser we're going to try when it comes and just try juicing our own and just draining out the pulp and see how that goes. It's just a bit of a ball. Like that's the only thing is squeezing your own. You know, you're like, again, with our clients, we really try and like a lot of them are women. They got multiple kids. They work full time. So it's trying to say, okay, look, what are the basic things you can do? Keep it simple, keep it easy, you know, like minimal supplements, you know, like we obviously did the talk on your vitamin E, which is great. So we've got that in our website. The ones that are going to have the most bang for the buck, for their buck, without spending thousands on supplements, I think. Yeah.
Do you find a lot of your clients are like taking, like when they come to you, they're on omega-3s, they're on ascorbic acid, iron.
Multivitamins. Yeah. Really multivitamins and greens powder. Yeah. Fish oil. I'm like, oh, stop taking that shit. You know? I remember when I competed in like I was doing fitness competitions, my coach had me taking 8 tablets a day. Crazy, eh? Eight. Then I was taking flaxseed oil in my morning tea, no saturated fats, heaps of green vegetables. The last 2 weeks I ate fish and green vegetables at every meal. That's it for 2 weeks.
It's interesting how the whole green movement, because I was in that whole chlorophyll, you know, kind of turn into a plant, just saturate your body with greens. Mm. That's so interlinked with omega-3s from what I've seen. Like people that are promoting either one, I mean, they're like, you know, unlimited vegetables, no sugar, and here's your omega-3s.
Yeah. Like, you know, something I used to always see was, if you're hungry, just fill up on green vegetables. That's what I used to do, you know, because they're really filling and they've not got many calories in them at all. But it's so interesting. Like I'll get a lot of people comment on my Instagram, like if I ever write about green vegetables, they're like, yeah, but you don't eat green vegetables, Kitty. Like where are you getting all your nutrients from? And, you know, often I'll just say, well, what nutrients are there in green vegetables that you can't get in other foods in higher amounts in a form that's easy to digest? And they don't know. Like me, like I was brainwashed. I used to eat them thinking that they were good. But when you actually dig a bit deeper and you're like, well, we don't make the enzyme to break down cellulase. So like, how can it be so nutritionally important when we don't even make the enzyme to break it down? There's all these like anti-thyroid substances, goitrogens, and they taste bitter. You know, like you bite into some broccoli or cabbage and it's bitter. You know, I remember working with Emma and she said, you know, bitter means poison, Kitty. I'm like, oh, it makes so much sense. You know, like what tastes nice? Potatoes with salt and butter, fresh fruit, ripe fruit, juice, really, really sweet juice, you know, ice cream, custards. Green broccoli, like cabbage, doesn't taste nice. It tastes bitter. You know, so I think if you go back to that, like just keeping it simple, looking at the foods, are they easy to digest? What nutrients do they have in them? Like, you know, we both bang on about the liver and the oysters all the time, you know, But these are just such easy things that people can do to improve their health. And when you're healthy and you listen to your body and you eat to your hunger, your body's going to naturally fall at the weight it's supposed to be at, you know, like.
Yeah. Yeah. And once you have all this stuff down that you're talking about, you don't even have to restrict that stuff. Like I love, like there's a restaurant that has like this really good, like dandelion, arugula, like balsamic vinaigrette, there's some tomatoes on there and shredded carrots. And I love it. It tastes really good. I'll have that with some steak or something and some other and some carbs. But it's like a couple times a month, if that. And so, you know, if I was going to have salmon, it's like once a week or less, because you don't have to restrict anything, right? It's just eat and less of it.
Yeah. And when you're like, your metabolism's good and your digestion's strong, you're making lots of, you know, hydrochloric stomach acid and you break it. Like I'm the same. Like I can eat, like I'll go eat a pizza. Like we just, this is amazing Italian place, not pizza, not sourdough or anything. It's just standard flour, like, and they have all these amazing toppings and I'm fine. You know, or I'll eat some green vegetables in a curry and I'm fine. It's not like I go, oh, I just don't purposely go out and buy a shit ton of green vegetables and eat them. But you're right. Like when your metabolism is good and your digestion's good, you can handle these foods and yet don't have any issues. But I think it's people will go like, oh, it's like we've got this mentality that if a little bit of something's good, we think we need to eat a shit ton of it. Do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I've been there, and it's definitely a thing. I think in certain contexts, like I can't get enough of beef liver right now, or ruminant liver. Like I can't get enough bison or beef liver, and my body's just like, because I've had skin issues my whole life and eczema, acne, and I know that retinol copper is so linked to skin, and my skin's awesome now. It's the best it's ever looked. But I really attribute that to ruminant animal liver and eating a lot of it.
and I think too, like obviously as you have a really high metabolism, so you need more nutrients. So, and I'm the same, like I eat more liver than the standard, you know, like we say to people 100 grams a week. I mean, I get a lot of sun too, and I just think my body just, I do well on more liver, you know, like you. And I guess, isn't it? It's just about like finding the foods that help you function at your best and feel your best. And I think that's what I like about Ray Pete. You know, it's not about that this diet is the best for everyone. It's about like, okay, how do you measure good health? Well, Emma said to me when in one of her consults, she's like, if someone was healthy, Kitty, like how would you describe them? Like what attributes would they have? And I'm like, okay, cool. Well, their skin would be glowing. They'd maintain their weight relatively easy. They'd sleep well. They'd have pain-free, you know, regular menstrual cycles, good energy, good sex drive. They'd be fertile. So it's like, okay, well, you know, and their warm body, you know, 37 degrees, so strong pulse. So it's like, what diet do you need to eat to achieve that? That's the diet that's best for you. But I've never seen anyone achieve that being a vegan or like doing carnivore or like, you know, obviously there's foods that we all recommend that's like, you know, there's certain foods that are going to digest easier and have the nutrients. But I think it's like you say, like finding what amounts, how often, you know, how much you need to eat, that's going to be different for everyone. And that's where I think that this is so powerful, because it allows you to take control back of your own nutrition in your body, and you understand what works for you and you know the signs and the symptoms. Like I know now, like, I mean, I'm an athlete at heart. I strength train heavy. Like I love it. And our business is stressful. And there's some months, you know, maybe I haven't been as diligent with my food, or it's really stressful and my period will shorten and I'll get cramps. And I'm like, whoa, you know, Kitty, time to dial it back. You need to just, this is your body telling you that you've pushed it too much, but I know what to do now. And I think that's so great for women, is understanding what their symptoms mean and how that they can improve them with diet and lifestyle changes. Yeah. And pretty that's simple awesome. Diet and life. I think like, you know, train less, eat more, rest more. Like it's not that hard.
Yeah. I posted something, I think yesterday, was like being too serious is a sign of stress. There's so many signs. Cause I noticed like people where their metabolism's messed up, like they're restricting sugar or they're restricting animal protein, you know, carnivore or vegan or whatever kind of extreme diet. They're very serious, and they might just, you know, they can't take a joke, or they don't joke, and, you know, never smile. And it's like, I mean, I think taking life too seriously is like a sign that your metabolism's messed up.
Well, you probably remember what it was like. I remember when I was like cutting carbs and calories and sugar, like I just felt like I was going to lose my shit at a drop of a hat, you know, and everything was, I wasn't sleeping. So everything felt 10 times worse than it already was. And I think, like you say, when you switch over to this pro-metabolic eating, you become more resilient, you're happier. Like you can cope with stress, like shit that would piss you off before would probably not, you know, worry you so much now. I mean, like we always have a good chat and a joke and, you know, and we got on and talk and you seem like such a happy, smiley person. Like Craig and I were talking, I was like, every time I get on a Zoom call to Matt, he's just so smiley. He's just such a happy guy.
Well, thank you. Yeah, you too. And that's the cool thing about this community is like we can kind of support each other and, you know, kind of remind each other to like smile and be lighter. And yeah, it's awesome. It's definitely, I mean, looking at the world right now with politics and it just seems like, you know, brink of civil war and all this craziness. It's like our stressors have never been higher. I mean, let alone just social media and all the dings and the constant stimulation. I think people looking at like ancestral living and how we used to do things is not really accurate because we have so much more stress now, which means our nutrient needs are higher, right?
Yeah, and our energy needs are higher. Like, you know, women weren't running businesses and working full time and trying to raise three kids and, you know, like then trying to train. It's like they lived in the village with no, like they, job was to hunt, like gather and, you know, look after the kids. You're so right. It's really, we do need more nutrients. We need more energy. I think though too, like I find with a lot of women in our program, and I've had to do it myself because I'm a very like energetic person, happy, you know, like, and I love to do a lot of things and I love to grow our business and I love to train. And sometimes I push myself too hard and I have to really like Craig, I feel like Craig and I need to like realign ourselves every 3 months because we work in our business, we train, and we're both really passionate about our business and getting results for women. So we're constantly trying to improve our program and, you know, we're really invested in seeing people succeed, but sometimes that works against us because we'll find ourselves like, oh, getting back into bad habits of working really late at night, working on the weekends, then we stop having sex and spending time together. And I think being healthy, relationships, connections, sex with your partner is really important. And then we start to get disconnected and then we sit down and we're like, okay, come on. Like, yeah, you can obviously fuel your body and get the nutrients in, but at some point you have to rest and you have to disconnect and you have to get out into nature. And, you know, like I am the first to put my hand up and go, I get sucked back into this trying to do everything, you know, and then we go, okay, cool, we'll finish at, you know, 6:30, phones off. We sit at the table and have dinner and have conversation instead of sitting in front of the TV. We make more time to connect and have sex. And then we're like, you know, order is restored once we have sex again. And I feel like so many other couples and women and men would probably feel the same. But yeah, I don't know. Like I think it's pretty normal. You get sucked into this world of go, 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 busy, busy, busy. And I think that the nutrition part of it is one part of it. But I really feel like people don't place enough importance on the other parts of healing, which is your relationships, maybe past trauma, your work. You know, those things, I think you can do everything right with the food, but if you hate your partner and you're in this toxic relationship or if you're in a job that you hate and you have no purpose, that's going to affect your body's ability to heal and potentially lose weight. So I think it's like a holistic approach.
That's awesome. Yeah, it's so much more than food. And I think there's more like online business owners now than ever, especially with the whole, you know, virus thing or whatever. And that's a good reminder for me because I used to do the one meal a day. I would set my timer for 1 hour and just binge on beans and soy. And it was really bad. And, you know, now I realize I was doing the wrong type of fasting. Mm. You know, I shouldn't fast with food. I should fast from social media. And I mean, even short periods, even one day a week or every 2 weeks, or trying to find the rhythm that works for you. But I think that's great advice for any like business owner that has their business online, you know, whatever it is, because taking that break, sometimes that's all you need. you know, and even better if you're not alone, if you're with somebody or something, so you can have that human interaction.
That's so, and you know what, like I wrote about this a few weeks ago, because like I think everyone's been affected by Corona, you know, all of us have been affected, and we haven't had a holiday since like last year. Corona hit, we've been so busy, we launched Saturday, and just not me being me, nonstop. And I'm really diligent with my food. I'm really diligent with training, recovery. I mean, I get a lot of sun, but I just spend a lot of time working on social media, on Instagram, and I sort of hit this wall. Like I got to this point and I was sitting there and I was like, I said to Craig, I feel really flat. I feel really like sad. I actually had a few big cries too, like really cries. And he's like, you need to take a break, Kitty. Like you've been go the whole year. So I took like a week and a half off training. I put some better boundaries in around, like you said, social media. Made more time to connect with Craig and my family and friends, and I just felt so much better. So I think you're so right. And look, I am someone who still struggles with that, because part of growing our business is being on social media and connecting with people. But you're right, like we've got to connect to people like in real life. Not real life, but I know what you mean. But I still have to really remind myself to not do that, like be on social media from the moment that I wake up till I go to bed. You know, it's hard.
It is. Yeah. I mean, that's another reason why we have increased energy requirements. And I've been trying to kind of biohack that and use different ways, you know, because we have to maybe use technology or unnatural methods to balance that out, which might include sucrose, white sugar, which people think is poison.
But I know. I can't believe that. I think to myself, well, how did I even survive eating so little calories and no sugar? Like, I don't even know. But yeah, I think, and again, it can, when you're on social media all the time, and I don't know if you've ever felt this, but I'm sure other people do it, you get into this comparison game. You know, like you look at what other people are doing, you lose focus on what you're doing, you know, like I've sometimes will scroll through social media and, you know, I'll see other not that I'm a fitness model, but like, you know, other, like they're in a similar market to me and, you know, they're so lean and they're all got their Botox and, you know, and I'm like, oh man, like, you know, I'm not getting Botox anymore and got all these lines, like, look at these lines. Like, even when I was looking, I was like, oh God, but I'm like, fuck, you're only 40, Kitty. God, you got to accept that you're going to have lines, you know? And I think, oh, I should be leaner. And it's just, you get sucked into this. You know, I think social media can be a bit damaging to people. Like, I mean, you've just got to, I think, see it for what it is. And like, people's lives aren't perfect, and what you see is not always true.
There's fake boobs, right? We didn't talk about that. Yeah.
Yeah, fake boobs, which I'm getting out in 3.5 weeks. They're everywhere.
Right. I was shocked. I mean, because I heard about, was it called breast implant illness, right? Mm-hmm. BII. I heard about that like a couple, I think maybe 2 or 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. And now I just see it more and more. And I mean, women I didn't even know they were fake, they're like, yeah, I need to get mine out. And I'm like, So it's a whole almost like niche of healing that I'm seeing. Like, yeah. Women are experiencing huge issues. No pun intended with that.
Yeah, and look, I've never experienced any of those issues that they took. I've done a lot of research into it too. But for me, you know, I got them in after I got divorced. So I was really sad and I was looking for validation externally, thinking that if I got the boobs, it would make me happier and I'd feel better about myself. And I got them. And I remember a few weeks later waking up and still just feeling sad. You know, and back then that was when I was still doing all the restrictive diets. And then obviously I met Craig and found Ray and Emma and Rob Turner from Function. I should mention him. He's amazing. Like, we bought his Popping the Food Bubble program. We learned heaps from him and Dodie, which I'm really grateful for. But, you know, then I've just evolved and grown, I think, since then. And, you know, for me, like, I really feel like to me, leadership by example is so important. You know, it's like I can't be like preaching one thing and saying you should do this, but then, you know, I'm pumping myself full of Botox and having fake boobs. Like, it doesn't align. It doesn't feel good to me. And also the health, you know, ramifications too. You know, I don't think anyone could argue that having silicon in your body is good for you. Like, it just can't be. Yeah. It can't be. I just made the decision that I'm just going to go and get them out. So I'm excited. I'm actually really excited about getting them out. Like, they're just really big. And I mean, Craig likes them, but, you know.
It's so funny.
Go ahead. I'm like, are you still going to love me with no big boobs? He's like, Kitty, of course I'm going to love you. He's like, I will love you with big boobs, small boobs. I just want you to be happy is what I want. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's really cool. Yeah. I was just going to say, like, with men, it's just social media is such BS because it really distorts men and women's view of what an ideal body is, right? Mm. There's no ideal, but it's like for men, I think a lot of them are on human growth hormone, you know, maybe not PRT, but a lot of it's HGH, which if someone has money, they could just get on. And I know there were famous YouTubers that died or
really
got sick or they crashed because they built this millions and millions of following and then they crashed because, you know, I mean, because you could sell a greens powder, or whatever your product, if you just lift up your shirt, you know, so it's like it's rampant. I think it's more rampant than people imagine, you know.
Yeah, totally. And look, you know, all these women that are really lean and these men that are really lean, they're not necessarily healthy. Right. You know, a lot of them, you know, I knew when I was at my leanest, I was the most fucked, you know.
I mean, you can do Coke, right? You can do lines of Coke every day and be super lean and look great.
At one point I was addicted to speed. I remember I would get up in the morning and I would have a line of speed. I'd have coffee and then I'd smoke. And I'd love it because I would just never be hungry. Like, it was the best way to not eat. And I was just on all the time. So, yeah, you're right. And I was lean and skinny and everyone would be like, oh, you look so good, Kitty. But I was a mess, you know.
Yes, celebrities or act, right? I mean, that's pretty rampant. We know that that goes on. So, yeah, we definitely can't look at others as examples. It's like, stop comparing yourself, right?
Oh, totally. It is hard. And I think... And that's why I talk about things so openly on my social media, because I feel like everyone struggles with this shit and everyone thinks the same thing, but no one talks about it. And I think, oh, it's just really good to show that I still think that shit sometimes. I still have dumb thoughts. I still compare, but I've really just, and like, I guess I always come back to like, what's your highest intent, Kitty? Like, what is it that you value? What is it that you're trying to achieve and help women with? It's like, that's what you've got to come back to. And I just could never be that so lean again and so tiny because I was miserable. Like, it just wasn't, you're just existing, you know, and you're not living your life and you're tired all the time and all you do is think about food and, you know, it's just, I don't know, were you ever like that when you're back in your old diets?
Oh, yeah, when I was keto vegan, I had insane cravings and if I went out to a restaurant with my friends, I was like, everything on the menu looked good. Like, I wanted to order every single thing. I just couldn't get enough food. Mm. And distorted body image. I mean, I had, you know, I looked more ripped, but at the same time, my metabolism was trash and I had mood swings and brain fog and energy dips. And I'm sure my hormones were completely messed up. So it's really nice to know, being in this community, that I'm on the right track, that, you know, it's going the right direction. Everything's balancing and it takes time. I mean, I'm only 2 years in because I've done so many crazy experiments the last decade. Right. But because that's the question people always ask, like, how long does it take? You know, it's like, how do I speed it up? And I feel like supplements could help. Right. Like, I use niacin, niacinamide, aspirin, vitamin E, different things, and those really helped, I feel like, to speed it up. But
totally I think it's like we always tell our clients, food is the foundation. Like, you can't be going, I'm taking all the supplements but I'm not consistently balancing my blood sugar and doing all the basics, liver, oysters. But I'm like, you're right, once you get those basics down pat, you can, we've had good results too with our clients using those mentioned supplements. Not everyone has to take them, but yeah, they've seen some really good results. But I think, again, it's like, I feel like a lot of people will be, I'm not consistent with my nutrition, but I just want to throw the supplements in there. And I think that's going to be the magic thing, but it really is. It's like, you've got to, you know, like, get those right foods in, eat consistently, balance your blood sugar, eat enough, you know, But yeah, like I take aspirin and vitamin K and vitamin E, and yeah, we recommend a lot of clients, you know, especially if they've got issues with blood sugar, handling blood sugar, take the niacinamide, which is really good. They've got a lot of fat to lose and it's cheap too. Yeah. You know, niacinamide is not expensive. But it's the whole, the sugar, just the cravings. I agree. I was the same. I would have these epic binges where I would just like literally, I could consume like 5,000 calories plus in a sitting. And then I would make myself throw up and take laxatives. Wow. Yeah. So bad.
Jeez. So scary. Yeah, the ice cream thing was one of the best things for me. I think, you know, coming off veganism and raw veganism, especially, I thought ice cream was the most evil thing because it's like, oh, refined sugar and you have mucus forming dairy and you have saturated fat and all the things I used to think were poison. And now looking at it, it's like, wow, there's casein, there's lactoferrin, which helps, you know, inhibit iron and help with iron overload. And there's protein. It's the perfect food.
It is.
I mean, especially if you make it at home and if you buy it, there's minimal gums, right? No carotene.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's cheaper. There's not many really good ice creams you can buy here that don't have any shit in them. There's only really Haagen-Dazs and there's this other one, Lick, but they're really expensive. So if you buy the ice cream maker and make your own, you could probably make it for like half the price of what you'd buy.
I'm going to get on that because I want to use your product, and it'd be fun to mix in colostrum. I'm a big fan of colostrum powder.
Yeah. Yeah. Try it. You got to get the ice cream, get the ice cream maker.
Do you use Cuisinart? I think I saw yours. That I have I think I have a hand crank one. It seems like a lot of work.
Get the, honestly, it's like, it's expensive. It's like $500. People are like, oh, it's too expensive. I said, it'll pay itself back. Like, and you just, all you do is cause it's built in the cooling part of it. So you just pour it in, turn it on 60 minutes. It's done. You got ice cream.
Wow.
It's like soft serve. So, you know, one of my favorite things is like getting it out after it's just finished and it's really like soft serve, soft and delicious. And I'll just eat it. I went through a stage where I was making rum and raisin ice cream. I just love rum and raisin ice cream so much.
Wow.
Yeah. It's like soaking the raisins in rum.
I've never heard that.
Oh, it's incredible. It's so good. Yeah. But then I got a bit lazy. Like the vanilla one's just really easy.
Yeah, I have a bunch of vanilla powder. I have all the ingredients. Right after this, I'm going to order it.
I think you should, Matt. Get on it. You won't regret it. Hey, you'll be like posting your little videos of that. And it's just easy. It's just easy. I like easy and simple, you know?
Yeah, usually save money too, and it's higher quality. Like I buy my bone broth because there's a good company like El Campo that sells in California and they ship. But, you know, it's, You control the water. I mean, you control the ingredients whenever you do it yourself. So,
yeah,
you know, it's always better. But awesome, Kitty. Well, do you want to wrap it up? Is there anything else that, I mean, that was awesome. I think that's a lot of good practical info for people and inspiration.
Well, hopefully, like just a bit, you know, like probably not like some of your other, I probably swear too much as well, but just, you know, like bring it back to basics and, you know, eat food like our grandparents used to eat. You know, I remember Emma was talking to me in our first consult and she's like, you know, Kitty, when you went to your grandparents' house, what did you eat? And I'm like, you are so right. Like my grandma used to cut up pawpaw from her tree and she'd squeeze oranges fresh and drain the pulp. We'd have homemade custards, homemade ice cream. She'd make steak and kidneys on toast for my granddad, homemade breads, big roast meats. I never remember eating green vegetables. We had like parsnips, potato, pumpkin. She'd cook in lard. Wow. Lots of eggs, you know, Emma's like, this is just going back to what your grandparents used to eat. It's nothing crazy. Just eat like that. And I'm like, oh, that makes so much sense.
Yeah. A lot of my relatives are in Pennsylvania and I haven't visited there in a long time, but when I did, I remember when I was younger, it was like Amish central. Like there are a lot of Amish farms around. And I just remember being there. Like I just feel healthier. Like the stores seem healthier.
And
I think that's where the light bulbs can start going off with people. Cause I was on that fake BS Smart Balance butter where it's like canola oil first. And all these fake ingredients. It's like, that's the whole marketing to get us off of saturated fat and onto these PUFAs.
Yeah.
And it was like the seed oil industry and then the estrogen industry and it was all kind of a marketing scam to get us off of the farm, you know, from farm.
Make money.
And, out of the factory.
Grains, cheap, right. You know, like it's just good old fashioned, nutritious, easily digestible food. Like that's it. That's how I think about it now. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And animal based, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Eggs, cheese, yeah. Milk, all the yummy food.
I love it. Well, awesome, Kitty. I'll put all the links to all your stuff below in your program. Is it Win at Life, or that's your podcast, right?
So yeah, the main program we have is for women is Win at Life program, and then we're actually releasing a men's program early next year. We're just waiting for our app to be finished, which has been so stressful and so long and cost so much money. I'm like, oh God. But you know, you just don't know these things when you go into it. So we're lucky we eat so much sugar, so it's been okay. So we'll release that in the men's program. And then we've got Saturate, which is our skincare. Well, that's coming next year, early next year. We've done the formulation. It took us over 12 months. So that's exciting. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, yeah, I'll put all the links below for you guys to check out Kitty's stuff and support her, because she's awesome. And just thanks for coming on and sharing your wisdom.
Well, thanks so much for having me.
All right. Isn't Kitty awesome? She's hilarious. She always makes me laugh. And I just really love talking with her. And I love how real she is, you know, cussing and all. Even though I don't cuss that much. But I believe that different people need different delivery styles. And if someone doesn't resonate with me, great. There's a million other people that, not a million in this community. We're actually a very small minority within the alternative health community. But you know, maybe thousands of other people that they'd jive more with to, you know, heal the metabolism and come back into balance from all this yo-yo extreme jumping from diet to diet. It was a big breath of fresh air for me when I found Dr. Raymond Pete and Georgie Dinkoff and Kitty and Danny Roddy and all these people in the community that are sharing information that is so counter to really 99% of what you hear in the alternative health community. You know, refined sugar is evil and fat is fuel, and fat's the ideal fuel and it's better than carbohydrate or sugar. And there's all these little myths when that doesn't reflect reality. And I really noticed my stress levels go down and my resilience to life events go way up when I started to live this way. And people like Kitty are huge inspirations to me and reminders, because I fall off the wagon here and there. I get really busy with Mitolife and creating content for you guys and just working and phone calls, and I'll start slacking on things like the carrot salad, which is all about consistency, because you can do it here or there, but you won't see as much of a benefit as if you did it every single day. Same thing with, you know, carbohydrates and gelatin or bone broth and animal protein consistency. It's all about consistency, because that's what will give results. It's not just about, you know, wham, bam, once or here or there, and I'm good, and then on to the next thing. No, you actually have to stay on it, plan ahead, and be consistent, because that's when you'll start to see shifts. Your body temperature and pulse will start to trend upwards. Your resilience to stress will start to trend upwards, and everything just gets better. You have more stable mood. You don't have those midday energy dips. Your sleep gets better. Your libido goes through the roof. Your memory improves. Everything just gets better when you support your system and you stop starving it. And all of these little other things like supplements, it's extra, right? So that's after the foundation. You add in niacinamide, vitamin E, you know, gelatin, collagen, cascara sagrada, like she talked about. I haven't experimented with that one yet. That's pretty interesting. And you can experiment once you have the foundation down, but I feel like a lot of people jump into the additional things before just getting the basic foundation down, which is animal foods, animal-based nutrition, because there's a lot of nutrients that are only found in animal foods, namely retinol, which is preformed vitamin A. Bioavailable copper is really rich in shellfish, like oysters, and ruminant animal liver. And that's so important to regulate iron overload. Right after this interview, I actually ordered a Cuisinart 2-quart ice cream maker. It's just all automatic. She inspired me there as well to get on the homemade ice cream, because I posted the one that I use, which is relatively clean. We're not talking about Häagen-Dazs or, you know, a regular brand. I use a smaller brand called Double Rainbow that I've been consuming for the last few years, but there's still a few gums in there. There's no carrageenan, which is good, but there's a few gums, and people say that that's really harmful to the gut. So obviously you do your best. You know, I'm not going to stress about that one iota, but if you can make your own super high quality ice cream at home, and me being in Idaho, I have access. I mean, that's one of the biggest reasons why I moved to this state, to have access to high quality dairy foods, let alone be able to have my own goats and produce my own dairy. But the cow dairy here is poppin'. It's incredible. The milk, raw milk in every grocery store, it's so easy to get this superfood. And I feel like the health of a lot of people started to go off track once they cut out dairy, because they were consuming dairy that was fortified with Martin Marietta NASA-sponsored, genetically modified, human DNA-spliced algae oil poison, aka DHA, because they add that to a lot of milks. And then you have to add, why are they adding synthetic vitamin A, which we know from the research that that feeds pathogens and will contribute to infectious disease? And why are they adding secosteroid hormone D, otherwise known as vitamin D3? You got to start questioning these things. And if you see that going on, then you could start to take a step back from even the alternative health world and say, whoa, 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 guys, why are you supplementing D3 with K2? That doesn't make any sense. Why are you supplementing omega-3 that's being pushed by all of these really sinister organizations that don't have our best interests at heart? Same thing with synthetic vitamin A. Just get your vitamin A from animal foods, pastured eggs, dairy, butter, cheese. These are actual sources of retinol, beef liver, grass-fed beef liver. So I'm really excited to get on the homemade ice cream, because I consume a lot of it. I'll usually put on some reishi syrup for my friend Brandon over at Shen Blossom, and it adds a little... It's a fermented barley syrup with reishi spores and fruiting body, and it just takes it to another level. And usually that's my nightcap, is a little bowl of ice cream. And it's really funny. It's another thing in the mainstream alternative health community. They'll say, don't eat before you go to bed. But you can track it. Like, I use an Oura ring that uses infrared light to measure your HRV and deep sleep and REM sleep and body temperature drop, which naturally happens at night. And it'll show me how my sleep was when I had ice cream right before going to bed. And guess what? It's awesome. And the reason why it's awesome is because it's filling my liver with glycogen, which is needed to actually mitigate the stress response. So once your liver is drained, its battery is drained, it doesn't have sugar, that's when you have insomnia. That's when you wake up in the middle of the night at 3 or 4 a.m. because your cortisol spiked because your liver didn't have fuel. Because yes, you need energy to sleep. It's not about skipping dinner. It's not about intermittent fasting and eating breakfast and lunch and skipping dinner. That will wreck your metabolism over time. And these are the principles that Kitty and Craig talk about with their Win It Life program. And it's so important for people to learn these very basic things about human physiology, because I took nutrition class in community college and it was actually pretty accurate with all this stuff. But once I got into other programs of studying health and you start to see where the mainstream dialogue is, it's all about restriction. And it's going along with, it's actually exacerbating people's orthorexic tendencies. And they play on the supplement people and the cleansing people and the multi-level marketing people. They play on your insecurity for having that body fat. And guess what makes you fat? It's not sugar. It's polyunsaturated fats. And it's estrogen and endotoxin. And all of these things that you never hear about. They just say, cut back on sugar and starve yourself to lose weight. That doesn't make sense at all, and you're going to crash. And people do crash. And those people become clients of Kitty and I and all the other people that I've had on the podcast. But hopefully you didn't have to suffer like that, because it's not fun. So I'll put the link below to where you can check out Kitty's work. She's on Instagram. She's really active on there, Kitty Blomfield. So check out the show notes to connect with them and do their program. They're really doing awesome work. As always, if you want to support the show, matt-blackburn.com. I often get messages, Matt, where do I buy magnesium bicarbonate? Where do I buy methylene blue? And most of those questions could be answered just by going to that website, matt-blackburn.com, because I have all of them there, mostly with discount codes, and it helps me out. It helps support the show, and you also save a little bit of money with buying the products. So I've been pointing a lot of people to the Mitigate Stress Magnesium Bicarbonate, Nick and Nathan, really cool guys, trigger pointing guys, bodywork guys, and they have this liquid magnesium product that is just awesome. And if you have been really stressed out, you went through a traumatic event, you moved, breakup, job change, this year has just been stressful for a lot of people. Sodium and magnesium are the main minerals to go under stress. And there's other nutrients that go, of course, but to ramp those up can be very beneficial. And so I actually use these little shots from Shen Blossom. They're a little kind of like sea salt shots, liquid shots. And I'll do one or two throughout the day in my little magnesium shot. And that fires up a lot of people. It's really interesting for me to get feedback about that, because some people, if they do a magnesium bicarbonate shot before bed, they're too energized. And so when you first have it in the morning before breakfast, you know, first thing upon waking, I just throw it in a shot glass and knock it back. Or if it's only you, just make it easy. Go to the fridge, take a swig right from the bottle. And Mitolife, exciting announcements for that. Niacinamide, NAD power supplement, is live and available on mitolife.co. And that is a specific form of vitamin B3. It's mostly referred to in the clinical literature as nicotinamide. This was a tool that I used when I was recovering from OMAD, one meal a day, vegan style, keto style. I was doing the exact opposite lifestyle of what I talk about today, because I didn't understand balance. I was trying to play God and I was trying to manipulate the system, and I was restricting, and I was in that never-ending search for the ultimate diet or the ultimate program, when in fact the ultimate program is called balance. And being into anti-aging, I was messing with niacin, I remember one of the first times I actually took 750 milligrams, that's scary, of niacin with black pepper extract, which I don't like because that super opens up the intestines and endotoxin can get through, anything can get through. And I flushed really hard. It looked like I had a sunburn for, I don't know, 45 minutes to an hour or something like that. And it's uncomfortable. And knowing what I know now about polyunsaturated fatty acids, that is really dangerous to use that form of vitamin B3, because niacin, flushing or not, will cause an increase of histamine, serotonin, and inflammatory prostaglandins. And it's very stressful, especially when the fat tissue, the adipose tissue, is composed primarily of polyunsaturated fats. Because people don't think about the fat tissue, is it predominantly saturated or polyunsaturated? And that really depends on your childhood. I know my childhood, I was squeezing my giant Pizza King slice of pizza the size of my head, and the grease was falling off of it. And I ate that once, twice, three times a week with my friends after high school. I'd go and get burritos. I was down in San Diego. I was megadosing Mexican food, and I was eating fast food. And, you know, obviously my parents were doing the best they could. And I was eating animal products. I think milk was actually my saving grace, even though it was conventional milk. I truly believe that milk is very protective, especially with its lactoferrin and other compounds in it that protect from, for example, iron filings in your freaking cereal. Milk is amazing. That's probably the healthiest thing you had growing up if you had a, you know, standard American kind of upbringing. And again, I'm not bashing on my parents. I'm not bashing on your parents. Obviously, they did the best we can, but let's continue to upgrade and let's get off the factory and back onto the farm, as Morley Robbins has said in a previous episode, because they got us hooked on the factory. And that is not sustainable at all. We have to get back to homesteads. We have to get back to cheese, eggs, milk, red meat, all of these traditional foods, and bone broth, chicken broth, beef broth. These are foods that actually build a healthy baby. These are the foods that build a healthy immune system. These are the foods that energize the human body. So back to this whole B3 thing. The unnaturally high amount of PUFAs, even if they're stored in our body now and they're being released through stress, that actually increases our need for things like niacinamide and vitamin E to counteract their immunosuppressive effects, their anti-mitochondrial respiration effects, and their metabolism suppressing effects ultimately. And so niacinamide and vitamin E have actually been used in certain treatments for diabetic patients in combination with, you know, a foundational approach and other things. So that's really interesting, because when I was studying diabetes years ago, I never heard of those two things. I never heard that polyunsaturated fatty acids increase your requirements for vitamin E. I never learned that vitamin E is not just an antioxidant, but an aromatase inhibitor. It actually protects against estrogen. And I never learned that estrogen is a stress hormone, not the female hormone. So there's a lot of stuff to unlearn. But bottom line is that if you take away the bad supplements, that's like liposomal vitamin C, ascorbic acid, that's like glutathione, zinc, vitamin D. And it's kind of scary because with this current quote unquote crisis, those supplements are being very heavily marketed. And omega-3s, of course, right? Omega-3s for your immune system, but they're not going to tell you it's going to suppress your immune system. So anyway, a little rant there. I'll put the link below. I spent a lot of time writing that product page for that NAD supplement. And NAD stands for nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, and that is a key part of your metabolism. That it's called the NAD to NADH ratio, and that is actually skewed when you drink alcohol. So I know a lot of people are going to drink alcohol no matter what, but there are things that you can do to mitigate that goes way beyond those little, you know, herbal pills you might take before you drink. It's my current understanding that the best things you can take before you drink are fructose, so have a little bit of fruit, and niacinamide. Maybe 2, 3, 4 capsules if your body doesn't respond with loose stools to high-dose niacinamide. Mine does not. So I just want to share that just in case. Little fun experiment, homework assignment. And thanks so much for your support. There's a new episode every Friday. Please share this with your friends because I think that this information can help a lot of people that are confused and spinning their wheels and going to practitioner after practitioner and being prescribed omega-3s and zinc and ascorbic acid and all these supplements that are going to actually decrease their ability to utilize oxygen. And if you can't utilize oxygen, let alone get it to the tissue, then that's called necrosis. That's called cell death. That's called suffocation. And you can't make energy if your cells are suffocating. Today's quote is by the Nutrients Journal. The study is called A Review of Dietary Phytonutrients for Glutathione Support. Since the precursors and foundation of glutathione are amino acids, intake of dietary protein may influence the amino acid pool from which to draw to synthesize glutathione. Changes in protein consumption, including reducing protein levels but remaining within safe levels, may alter plasma glutathione synthesis levels, contributing to a reduction in antioxidant capacity.